You are about to start the audiobook of the book review of For Whom the Bell Tolls, a famous work by Ernest Hemingway. During this reading, you will first discover a brief context of the work and its author. Then, a summary of the work will be presented, followed by an analysis of the characters and the key points of the novel. Once these different points have been addressed, all that remains is to conclude this listening session with a few questions that may further fuel your reflection. The author. The novelist, short story writer, and journalist Ernest Hemingway was born in 1899 in a small Chicago suburb. After graduating from high school, he briefly worked for the Kansas City Star newspaper before being recruited by the Red Cross in 1918 and traveling to Italy to participate in the First World War. After witnessing war and death firsthand during his time there, these themes became constants in Hemingway's life, mind, and work. He survived two plane crashes in Africa, and later worked as a war correspondent in Spain during the Spanish Civil War, 1936-1939, and in France during the Second World War, 1939-1945. Most of his writing is heavily colored by his own experiences of war and blends autobiography, history, and fiction. He won the Pulitzer Prize in 1953 for The Old Man and the Sea and the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1954. And is considered one of the most influential American authors of all time. He committed suicide in 1961. The work For Whom the Bell Tolls is about the Spanish Civil War, and is based on the author's own experiences as a war correspondent in the country during that conflict. It tells the story of Robert Jordan, a professor from Montana in the United States, who is fighting for the Republicans and who has been ordered to blow up a bridge. In order to complete his mission, which will help secure a significant victory for the Republicans, he must befriend the guerrilla soldiers living in the mountains and convince them to help him. The story, which is over 400 pages long, unfolds over the course of 3 days, a short period of time which is nevertheless enough to completely change the way Jordan sees the world. During these 3 days, he will find love with a young woman named Maria, companionship with the elderly Anselmo, loyalty through Pilar's courageous resolve and, in the quiet moments of tension and anticipation, a profound existential awareness. Summary. Jordan arrives in the mountains. Spain, 1937. The Civil War is raging, and Robert Jordan, a former professor from the USA, is fighting for the international brigades on the Republican side as a dynamite specialist. General Goles has given him an extremely important mission to go into the Guadarrama Mountains, behind enemy lines, to blow up a bridge. However, he must time his actions perfectly to coincide with an offensive that will be launched by a different contingent of soldiers. Jordan knows that his mission is crucial for the cause, as the success of the Republican attempt to capture the city of Segovia, and any future advances, will hinge on whether or not the bridge is destroyed. In other words, his actions could have enormous consequences for the future of humanity, and could change the course of history. However, Jordan is also aware that he and the other soldiers are nothing more than tools in the hands of those who are conducting the war. Page 18. They are mere pawns who obey the chain of command. Although Jordan speaks fluent Spanish, he is not familiar with the area, which means that he needs a trustworthy guide. This role falls to the elderly Anselmo, a 68-year-old local farmer who knows the land and is well-respected. He also introduces Jordan to Pablo and the group of guerrilla fighters he leads. This group consists of 9 people, 7 men and 2 women, who live in a cave in the mountains, living off the land there while Augustin and Fernando keep watch for enemy forces. The group has already completed some successful missions, including a strike on a train transporting prisoners, which they are all extremely proud of. However, although Pablo is always met with an enthusiastic welcome, especially by a gypsy called Rafael, Jordan quickly learns that he is not to be trusted. While no one could doubt his loyalty to the Republican cause, Pablo is a very intelligent man who harbors doubts from the very beginning over whether or not Jordan's mission has any hope of succeeding, and may not be above sabotaging it. Pablo has become disillusioned and, in the words of his wife Pilar, this has made him a lazy, a drunkard, and a coward. Page 58. He is opposed to offering Jordan any help, but the rest of the group rebels against him and sides with Pilar, who supports the mission and takes charge of the rebel band from that point onwards. Jordan is then able to concentrate on familiarizing himself with the terrain and assessing the bridge, evaluating the risks his mission will entail and trying to recruit more people to help him carry it out, including another band of guerrilla fighters, which is led by El Sordo and counts the young Joaquim, who acts as a sentry, among its members. Although the mission seems simple in theory, a number of problems and bad omens begin appearing, which makes everything more difficult. For starters, a lot of airplanes which seem to belong to the enemy are flying overhead, which is very worrying. Worse still, it snows one night even though it is the middle of May, and although they all try to dismiss it, the snow is more than just a bad omen. It complicates their mission, and eventually gives away their location to the enemy. However, the obstacles they face are not all material in nature. On more than one occasion, Jordan finds himself harboring doubts about the justness of their cause, the necessity of killing, and the depravity of the war. These doubts are stirred up by Anselmo's musings on how killing is a sin even though we do not have God here anymore, page 44, and by Pilar's stories about the vengeful, sadistic massacre of the fascists in her village. On several occasions, Jordan tries to forget how innocent they all were when the war began and to dispel the feeling that men become crueler over time and kill without remorse, in other words, the idea that all causes become corrupted. A blossoming romance. Jordan boasts that he has no need of a woman and that he has never fallen in love. He even jokes about it with General Goals when the subject comes up, saying that he is too busy and focused to have the time to meet anyone. However, this soon changes, because Pilar is not the only woman in the camp, a young woman called Maria, who was rescued in their attack on the train carrying the prisoners, also lives there, and Jordan is captivated by her from the first moment he lays eyes on her. Maria has suffered a great deal at the hands of the phalangists, a fascist faction, who killed her parents and raped her. When she looks at him or approaches him, Jordan feels a lump in his throat, and he cannot control his voice, in fact, he can barely speak, because he has fallen in love. She also falls in love with him at first sight, and they become romantically involved the very first night after they meet each other. The second time they sleep together, they both feel a deep connection with the other and with the universe itself, which almost seems to be shifting around them. Jordan knows that the bond between them is unlikely to last long, given that anything can happen during a war, and resolves to enjoy every single moment they are together. He comes to the conclusion that, since they may not have much...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.